Good evening. How is everyone this evening?
Good. Burn it up.
It's all right.
You're the teacher, buddy.
We'll be back.
Forgot his King James version of the Bible.
That's right. I hope everybody's had a good week. Shortly going to go with Gordon Way of Prayer. Anybody have a special unspoken request by the uplifting of the hand? Amen. Bless each and every one of those. Anybody have a special spoken request they want to make known?
My cousins was in the hospital and they've diagnosed him with mild cerebral palsy. He's a neuromuscular disease. Very, very rare.
Amen. Bless that name. Anybody else?
Pray for Alyssa. She's hurting pretty bad. They said it's normal. Baby's going to be the 21st unless something crazy happens. So pray for us and the new little baby.
Litlin.
Yeah.
There's a mechanic. He owns a garage in Prestonburg. I actually took my state truck the other day to have it serviced. He was in the hospital over at Highland with COVID for 31 days, and right before then, he found out he had 4-stage throat cancer. And his name's Dale Mosley. Everybody remember him? He seemed like a really, really good feller. Seemed to know the Lord. Well, a little bit I talked to him, but he's really in a battle right now with his health. So just remember that. Continue to remember this church. I know we're going to do big things here. Remember this Bible study. Remember Brother Brian as he comes. He's really been a blessing to me, and I think he's been a blessing to each and every one of us. And I'm excited to see how he continues with this. Anybody else?
Brother Justin, I don't have my
name. Bless you, Greg. Remember me Sunday morning, I reckon I got to preach it. I hope nobody leaves. So. Thank you. All right. Brother Greg. You care to?
You can stand up or you understand?
I'd like you to stand up. But you don't have to.
No, I'll stand up. I'm just a little sore. So, Father, we ask you just to watch over this as we just come to know you better. Lord, we just ask that you just make it a lot easier on some of these people, and me especially. I ask that you just let us stay together in these hard times, Lord, and just let us grow as a church and continue to get bigger and bigger. And all thanks to you, Jesus' name, pray. Amen.
Amen. Bless you. Brother Brian, give us a little bit of homework to read the first 5 chapters of Daniel. I'm going to make a suggestion. This right here is a very... Has anybody ever read any Larkin stuff?
A little bit. Didn't I give you Clarence, a Larkin book?
Reverend Clarence Larkin. He's an old fellow too.
That book I give you a Larkin book?
It's a Larkin book. He's got a book. I ain't going to say I 100% agree with it, but he's got a book called Rightly Dividing. It's very good. And he's also got, these are his 2 biggest sellers. I mean, well, he's been dead for a long time, but I think. But this book of Daniel, it really, really breaks down Daniel's 70th week and shows, it was an eye-opener for me also. And it was something that helped me. I know when we first started this class, you know, I told you all about the Stan books and things that differ. You know, so anytime I get a little bit of reading information, I try to pass it along. So far, that's been 2 of my authors that I've kindly come to enjoy. So, but that Clarence Larkin, he's got, like I say, he's got the one Rightly Dividing, and then the Book of Daniel. He really breaks it down.
Are you going to check it out like a library book too?
Well, let me finish it. I'm only about halfway through it. Actually, I'm not even that far. I'm not on page 80. Brother Brian. Does anybody need any handouts?
I think she's getting the handouts.
Everybody good?
Okay. Good evening, everybody.
Hello.
It's good to be back. Thank you guys for having me. So we're in Daniel, and we're trying to set up Daniel's 70th week. And so you should have a map. Hopefully you guys got a new map. Did everybody get one of those?
Yep.
So to answer the question, Daniel's 70th week is the week that hasn't been fulfilled. And what do I mean by that? Well, there's a tribulation period coming, a 7-year tribulation that the book of Revelation talks about. And that is truly Daniel's 70th week. And so what we're trying to do is just prove God's word to be true. Now, I believe every word is true. And unfortunately, I've tried to prove it over and over not to be true so I could have my way. But each time I do, I end up as a fool and God be right.
Amen.
Yeah. So it's exciting because it's just amazing how things continue to tie in. So I just, for the new people here tonight, we started in this, but Daniel was a prophet. First, he was a eunuch. That means he was a young man. Him and three other young men, help me out,
Shadrach,
Meshach, and Abednego. These four were what they call eunuchs. That means they don't have all their male parts. They were captured by Nebuchadnezzar, that's the king of Babylon, which was spoken of in prophecy. That's what we really did last week, was prove that God said, Israel, you will not submit to me, so I'm going to put you in captivity for 70 years by a king from Babylon or Assyria, and that his name is Nebuchadnezzar. So Nebuchadnezzar comes and captures Israel, takes the four eunuchs to Babylon. Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And of course, you know, they were in the fire and then also the lion's den. So that's the big stories we know from these guys. But I'm just saying, this is how all this ties in Daniel. And so from that, Daniel has visions. I'm sorry, King Nebuchadnezzar has visions, but Daniel can interpret the visions. And so what King Nebuchadnezzar will do, he will ask Daniel what these dreams mean. I'm leaving a lot of details out here, but I'm just trying to get us all on one page. And so Daniel moves up in the kingdom because of his power that God has given him, as we all have. Our power is through God, not what we have, but what God has given us. So with that being said, that kind of gets us up to where we are. So if you want to turn in your Bibles to Daniel 9:24, or at the beginning of the notes, Daniel 9:24 should be on the beginning of your notes, if you have those. And let's just read those verses. And I think they're making more notes for whoever has come in late and needs notes. So I'll try to talk real slow until they come back. But in Daniel 9, verse 24 through 27, it says, 70 weeks are determined upon thy people and upon thy holy city to finish the transgressions and to make the end of sins, to make reconciliation for iniquities, and to bring everlasting righteousness, and to seal up the vision of prophecy, and to anoint the most holy. Now right there, does that sound like those people were saved?
No.
It doesn't, do they? Their sins haven't been forgiven, they've not been reconciled for their iniquity, and they're going to receive everlasting righteousness. Now I just want to point out, your sins are over. You are reconciled to God. We can find all this in the Apostle Paul's writings. And we will receive everlasting righteousness if we have believed on the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. So see that we're talking two different people, so we don't want to confuse God's message. Verse 25, now, therefore, and understand that from the going forth of the commandment to restore and to build Jerusalem unto the Messiah, the prince shall be cut off, shall be 7 weeks, and 62 weeks, and the street shall be built again, and the wall, even in troublesome times. And after 62 weeks shall the Messiah be cut off, but not for himself and the people of the prince that shall come. And I want to point out the P there is a little prince versus a capitalized prince in verse 24. So the capitalized prince we know is, somebody say Jesus. Thank you. And the little prince would be Satan. Everybody okay? So we're talking about two different princes here. Don't get confused on that. Detail matters in God's word. That shall come and shall destroy the city and the sanctuary, and the end thereof shall be with a flood, and unto the end of the war desolation are determined. And he shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week, and in the midst of the week he shall cause the sacrifice of the oblation to cease, and for the overspreading of the abomination he shall make it desolate, even unto the consummation, and that determined shall be poured out upon the desolate. So that sounds really bad, right? Whatever city this is going to be on, you don't want to be there.
Man.
And if you're saved and in the body of Christ, you're not going to be there. So that's the exciting news. That's the hallelujah moment for all of us, I hope. All right. I read real slow and messed up a whole bunch just for you to pass out more notes. We'll wait till she gets done. So, unfortunately, if you weren't here last week, we're on... I'll tell you where we're at here in just a second. I'm not here with you. We stopped on, I think, the second page. Is that right?
Yep. I talked to text Brian earlier this week, and it kind of gave me an aha moment. He probably already knew this, but when it talks about eunuchs, you know, Gentile leaders, Babylonian leaders, I mean, when we talk about eunuchs, they cannot reproduce, and they would castrate males. The most likely the ones that were more knowledgeable, wiser, ones that they didn't have as much authority, because we know that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they wouldn't kneel. They wouldn't, you know, they still prayed every day. You know, Daniel still prayed every day. They still served God. So and that's the way Satan works. I mean, he thinks, oh, I'll jump ahead of God and do this, but God's already got something else in store.
Amen. Absolutely. So we stopped in Jeremiah 29:10 there on your notes. Just find that. I think it's on the back page or page 2. Jeremiah 10. And so when I go through, I'll just say this. When I go through, if you want to go back, I try to give you every scripture to show how I build this story. We're building God's story. But it's not my story. It's God's story. So scripture speaks. And scripture makes the story for us.
Amen.
So in Jeremiah 29:10, for thus saith the Lord, that after 70 years be accomplished at Babylon, I will visit you and perform my good work toward you in causing you to return to this place. So you can see the Lord is talking, and he says, after 70 years, I'm going to come visit you, and I'm going to bring you back to where I took you from, and that would be Jerusalem, the holy city. All right, and so in your notes there, it should say, Daniel is visited by Gabriel, an angel, that tells him his people, that's Israel, would be restored to their land and in and from their captivity, is what that should say, and from their captivity. So think about this. Daniel studied the book of Jeremiah. He knew that they were going to be in captivity 70 years. He learned this from Jeremiah. Jeremiah is an older prophet than Daniel. Even in the book, Jeremiah is behind Daniel. So God's order of Old Testament's in chronological order. But in Jeremiah taught from 640 BC to 586 BC. Daniel started teaching in 605 BC. So you can see Jeremiah was before Daniel. This vision was upon Daniel's people and the Jews and the holy city of Jerusalem. We know that by verse 24 of Daniel 9. He said, this will be upon you, this wickedness that's going to happen.
Amen.
And we should not confuse this with the 70 weeks with the Gentiles or the church. It has nothing to do with it.
Amen.
If you rightly divide the book, you will clearly see that God's talking to Israel, talking to a nation that he has called out to be a light to the world, but they were stiff-necked and they would not let their heart be opened to look for the Savior, and they kept leaning on their own morals. So there's a huge difference in what we're doing right now. We are one body. I go to a different building, but we are all one body, saved by the same Jesus, believing on the same blood that washed every one of us.
Praise God.
And we're that way. Now, well, I won't go any further than that, but my point being is this is not it. God called these people to be special. Okay? All right, so the 70 weeks or the 490 years covered the period that the Jews are, by God's permission, dwelling as the people in their own land. It does not cover this present dispensation of grace. So what happens is God called time out in his plan.
Amen.
He wanted Israel to be the lead, but Israel wouldn't be the lead. Matter of fact, they killed his son, right? And so from then, he even let the Holy Ghost go in them and try to share it. But we know they stoned Stephen in Acts 7. And from that, God said, fine, I will put you in blindness as a nation. Romans 11:25 says, I will put you in blindness as a nation until the fullness of the Gentiles comes in. So Israel as a nation cannot be saved. But right now, there could be any Jew at any time be saved if they would believe in the death, burial, and resurrection.
Amen.
And they're in the body of Christ. But as a nation, God's not going to use Israel like he promised them until the tribulation period, or Daniel's 70th week, is fulfilled. Is everybody okay with that?
Amen.
Okay. So if you go to the map, and I gave you maps, but I don't have one. So hold on.
Which one do you need?
I got a new one. I kept trying to find better ones that say everything. Got a hundred of them, but...
At least I got one.
Okay, so you can see right there, the 49 weeks is the 7 weeks, and that's the very first over here on this side. And that's what he told Daniel. You're going to be in cap. I'm sorry, that's 60. That's not on there, is it? Make sure not. Oops. Okay. Let's back up. Yeah, it's in your other. When 606 BC, that's when he said to Nebuchadnezzar, go and take Israel. Now, that's not on that map, but from then, he did. So Daniel realizes there is a gap that's going to happen, and Israel is in bondage. Daniel's 70th week is the first week of the tribulation. We said that. That's left to be fulfilled. That's not been fulfilled. And how do we know that's not been fulfilled? Is Jesus Christ ruling and reigning on this earth?
No.
Did he say he was going to?
Amen.
Did he say he was going to do it for at least 1,000 years?
Amen.
Actually, he said he's going to do it forever. To his righteousness, no one will ever end it, right? His kingdom will be set up. So we know this has not been fulfilled yet. Because if it was, then we would see Jesus. But we know Jesus. He's in us. But we walk by
faith,
not by
sight.
So Jesus isn't here. Is everybody okay with that? I'm not making leaps and bounds here. This is just scripture. Okay, so let's keep going there in our notes. The context here is 7 years. We know this because Daniel is concerned about years. It's impossible to fit the events that occur in verses 24 through 27 into 490 days, weeks. Is everybody okay with that? We're going to prove it by scripture. And verse 27 speaks of a covenant being broken in the half of the 70th week, which agrees with Daniel 7:25. If you want to turn there in your Bibles, Daniel 7:25. So we want to be sure it's not days, right? Maybe I'm crazy and I'm talking about days, or maybe we're just talking about weeks. God uses different descriptions of what he uses in time limits. But in Daniel 7:25, he says, and he shall speak great words against the Most High. Now, who's the Most High?
God.
Very good. And shall wear out the saints of the Most High, and think to change the times and laws, and they shall be given into his hands until a time and times and dividing of times. Okay, so we need to figure out what that means. Everybody with me on that? So let's keep going. Daniel 12:7. Flip over in your book to 12:7 for me. All right, I don't hear very many pages turning, so I'm going to read on. And I heard a man clothed in linen and was upon the waters of the river, when he held his right hand and his left hand unto heaven, and swear by them that liveth forever, that it shall be for a time, times, and half a time, and when he shall have accomplished to scatter the power of the holy people, all these things shall be finished. Okay, so that's a prophecy. Somebody's raising their hands up, and there's going to be this length of time again, a time, and a times, and a half a time. So we need to figure it out. Turn all the way to Revelation, which is in the back of the book. Please. Revelation 11:2. Revelation 11:2. Please, if you have questions or there's something just doesn't line up, please ask. Right? Revelation 11:2. But the court, which is without the temple, leave out, and measure it not, for it is given unto the Gentiles, and the holy city shall there be tread underfoot 42 and 2 months. Okay? 42 and 2 months. I'm sorry, 40 and 2 months. So in the Jewish year, there's 360 days. 12 months makes 360 days. If you do the math on what I'm telling you on the 42 months, that's 3.5 years. Is everybody okay with that? Yeah, if anybody doesn't believe my math skills, try it out. But it really is 3.5. Okay. Now let's one, we don't want to take one verse, right? Because we want to build doctrine on Scripture, and God never just gives you one verse to go and do what you want with. So go ahead and go to Revelation 12:4 for me. Revelation 12:4. This is how we get in trouble when we just try to build something off one Scripture. Revelation 12:4, and it says, well, let's just start in 1, okay? Let's get context, because we're talking about Israel here. And there appeared a great wonder in the heaven, a woman clothed with the sun and of the moon, and under her feet and on her head and crown, a crown of 12 stars. And she being with child, travailing in birth and pain and to be delivered. Now that's talking about Israel. Birth pains are coming because Israel's under more and more pressure because of the Antichrist. If you do not read Revelation, I'm trying to help you out with this. That's what it's referring to. And verse 3, and there appeared another wonder in the heaven, and behold, a great red dragon, having 7 heads and 10 horns and 7 crowns upon his head. And he drew his tail and a third part of the stars of heaven, and did cast them to the earth. And the dragon stood before the woman, which was ready to be delivered, for to devour her soon as it was born. So do you see what's happening? Satan is trying to attack Israel. It's the same thing we're reading in Daniel. It's just a little bit different description. And she brought forth a man, child, who was to rule all nations with a rod of iron. Now, who is that? So see, the woman's Israel, and she brought forth Jesus. And Jesus is going to rule the world with a rod of iron. That tells you that in Isaiah. But anyway, and her child was to be caught up unto God and to his throne. So right there it tells us, where is Jesus sitting? At the right hand of God. Is everybody okay with this? See how Revelation gets excited? And the woman fled into the wilderness where she hath a place prepared of God, that they should feed her for 1,260 days. There's another number for us, right? We're trying to tie this together. So all this I'm trying to point out to you means it's 3.5 years.
Amen.
Is everybody okay? It's important to understand God's timeline. So 1,260 days ends up to be 1,260 days, which also turns around to be 3.5 years if you use a 360 year day calendar, which is a Jewish calendar, right? We have to think Jewish because we're reading Jewish stuff.
Amen.
That's so important. You get confused if you just try to do your math, your Gregorian calendar in this. Okay, are we all good?
Sure.
Or is everybody lost like a ball in high weeds?
No.
All right, that's good stuff. Let's go back to our notes, please. So I want you to look here where it says rapture on your map. On the new map, yep, on the new map. There should be a rapture almost in the middle of the screen. Now, I want to ask you guys a question, and I believe the church believes in the rapture here, and I don't want to overstep my boundaries at all. But we believe there's a calling away, and we know that only by the epistle Paul, by Paul's epistles, that tell us about the calling away of the church. That is one of the great mysteries and the excitement in my life for me. So if you understand that and you believe you're in the body of Christ, you're in his true body. Does everybody believe that?
Amen.
And the book clearly says that we will not endure wrath. Is everybody okay with that? I'm not. And then secondarily, was Christ sacrificed once for all sins? So would Christ's body ever suffer again?
No.
So you understand the calling away is imminent at any time. It's true. You can't deny it unless God's got it wrong. And I sure don't think God's got it wrong.
Amen.
Is everybody okay with that? So the calling away of the church, right? We're gone. And then after that, God is going to return back to his eyes, back to Israel, to focus in on everything he promised them. Now, does that mean it happens like this? We don't know. The scripture never says that, and I won't say that. What I'm saying is there will be a time that God will turn back to Israel to fulfill every promise, to fulfill the book of Revelation, and then finally, after Revelation, which is the tribulation, he will send his son to rule and reign on the earth for 1,000 years. Does that make sense?
Amen. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so hopefully this is Daniel's 70th week, what we're talking about, what we're just trying to prove by scripture what God has said. All right, so if we can go back to the notes. If you don't mind, take a time out. Go to Jeremiah, Jeremiah 30. I want to show you how Jewish this is, by the way. Jeremiah 30. And this just hit me. I reread my notes because, I just do. And I try to give you guys more and more nuggets as I'm learning because I get excited. And that's why I have so many typos in my notes, because when I'm reading, I start getting excited. I talk fast and I'm dictating it. And it just, there you go. Jeremiah 30, verse 6. Let's go to 5. Jeremiah 30, verse 5. And this isn't in your notes. But he says, "Thus saith the Lord, we have heard a voice of trembling and of fear and not of peace. And ask ye now, and see whether a man doth travail with child." Now remember what we were talking about in Revelation? About the travailing, the birth pains, keep going. Now, and obviously a man can't travail with a child because he can't have a child. You women are the only brave people in this building. "Wherefore do I see every man with his hands on his loins," right? Every man's scared at this point. They're scared, they're like, oh God, they're hunched down there. They're fearful. "As a woman in travail, and all faces are turned pale." They're scared to death because this is tribulation. This is God's wrath coming out on them. "Alas, for that day is great, so that none is like it. It is even the time of" who?
Jacob.
"Jacob's trouble, but he shall be saved out of it." Now let me ask you this, who's Jacob? And if you don't know, I'm not trying to embarrass you. There was a man called Abram. Yeah.
Jacob, there was a man called Abram. He had a son, Isaac. Isaac had a son, his name was Israel.
His name was Jacob.
Jacob.
And Jacob wrestles God. Remember, yeah. He holds on to his leg and he won't let go. And he says, "You got to bless me." He says, "All right, I'll bless you." He touches his leg, hurts his hip, walks with a limp. He says, "Your name's Israel." Wow, that's what we're talking about. So this is Jacob's trouble. The 7 years of Jacob's trouble is the 7 years of tribulation, which is the 7 years that belong to Israel. Yeah. Not to the body of Christ.
Amen.
If you don't rightly divide this book, you just stay confused.
Amen.
But if you'll rightly divide this book, man, it makes sense.
Amen.
Wow.
That is a wow, right? So I just saw, okay. Because I could get sideways, we could go sideways. All right. This date is given. I'm in the notes there. Okay, so the expression of the 70 weeks divided into three periods. 7 weeks, 62 weeks equals 69 weeks, right? I'm not making a mathematical error here, right? So the 7 weeks, the 62 weeks, and that's when the Messiah would be cut off from going forth of the commandment to restore and to build Jerusalem unto the Messiah. The prince is cut off. That leaves 1 week left to be fulfilled. Does everybody see that?
Amen.
Okay? That's what we're talking about in Daniel 9:24. This date is given to Nehemiah in the beginning of the month of Nisan, and that's the beginning month of the Jewish calendar. That's really our March-April. Why we have Passover. Okay? Is everybody familiar with Passover? The Exodus. Remember he said you put the blood on the doorpost because the death angel's going to come, and you take the lamb in on the 10th day, and on the 14th day, you slaughter the lamb, and you put the lamb on the door, right? And when you put the lamb on the door, the death angel passes your home, and when he passes your home, you'll know that I am who I am. And Egypt cried out, and they said, "Get out of here." That's real quick, about 10 chapters in Exodus, but everybody understands what I'm trying to say. This is Nisan, the first month of the Jewish year. And this is the 12 years of Ahasuerus, the king, which is on the 14th day of March 445. Now, if you go to your calendar, it begins at 445 BC. So what am I saying? I'm saying that Nehemiah got a word from this king, Artaxerxes, and he said, go and rebuild, just like God said he would. Okay? And it started in 445 BC. Everybody okay with me on that? And so guess what Nehemiah did? He started to go build the walls, and he started to build the city. And if you've ever read the book of Nehemiah, they were so fearful that they were going to get attacked, they were building their walls with one hand, they had spears and swords in the other hand. Okay? So you guys look up, you're nodding your head, so I guess you know the story. And I don't know how much you know, so I'm just trying to bring you along with it, and hopefully it makes sense. Okay, let's go on to our notes. Using the 360-day year, 12-month, 30-day Jewish calendar, right? So 30 into 360 is 12, and that's a Jewish year. Guess what that makes, too? A circle. No end, no beginning. That would be God, wouldn't it?
Amen.
He's pretty cool, isn't he? When we get married, we put something on our fingers, and I know my wife's going to look because I don't wear a ring. Anyway, when we put that ring on, right, it's everlasting. You see what the marriage represents.
Amen.
I mean, there's so much symbolism in the Bible. It's amazing. The planet, just this planet, is circular. Everything God does is amazing if you just looked at what all God does. All right, in accordance with his word of God, Genesis 7:11, and we're not going to go to all these, but I just want to prove to you or show to you. You go back and do this, please, on your own if you don't believe me, and you shouldn't believe me. Genesis 7:11, Genesis 7:24, Genesis 8:3-4, Revelation 12:6, all refer to a Jewish calendar being 12 months, 30 days, 360 days a year. Okay, that's scripture to show you how God counts. Everybody mm-hmm. okay with that? We won't go to that, but and the woman fled into the wilderness, and I'm in Revelation 12:6. You don't have to go there, I'll read it to you. And the woman fled into the wilderness where she doth have prepared of God that they should feed her for 1,203 score days. And we already talked about that. That's 1,260 days, which is 3.5 years. There's other scriptures there that show you what's going to happen in the time of the Great Tribulation, which is in the last half, on the last half of Daniel's 70th week. That's the Great Tribulation, right? That's when what they call the abomination of desolation happens.
Amen.
So Satan is going to set up in the temple, which means there has to be a temple built, by the way. And he is going to have a slaughter. We don't know what the slaughter is, but I'm going to guess it's a pig, since Jews don't eat pork. Thank God for grace. I love pork. But anyway, yeah, right? Bacon's good. Anyway, he's going to slaughter something. I don't know what it is, but I would submit to you to offend the Jews, it'll be pork. And then from there on, it will be hell on earth like we've never seen. That's why it's called Great Tribulation. Okay? Thank God we're not here. All right, so go on to your notes. I'm going to jump down there. The end of the 69th week falls on Palm Sunday, just before the Lord's crucifixion. This would show that the 69 weeks have been literally fulfilled with 1 week left of all the events to be fulfilled, which we know is the final 7 years of the tribulation in which the Jewish people, the nation of Israel, will be going through because they crucified the Messiah. This is the whole reason for the tribulation. This is the whole reason for the book of Revelation. They missed Jesus. We didn't miss Jesus. Are you with me?
Amen.
People are lost all the time. But God called a specific people, gave them a specific land, and told them, I want you to do specific things, and they said no. They went on their own accord, right?
Yep.
They took a little bit of grace, very little, and they mixed it with a lot of law. And unfortunately, we're doing the same thing today. We're still doing it today. That's exactly right. Okay, so...
I don't know if I would want to be Jews.
It's funny, isn't it? You're saved by grace, and all of a sudden you jump right back into Judaism. It's just something to think about. We say that quite often at our church. So, again, here's a little nugget. I don't know if you guys want to go on a nugget or not. We can keep on, but this just hit me while I was doing the study. I give you some scripture there to read, and if I've got nine different scriptures there in the Gospels, and the question is why did Jesus tell them not to tell, right? Remember in his Gospels, he would tell the disciples, don't tell, and he would make a have a miracle, and he'd tell them not to go tell. You ever wonder about that, or am I just the only one? You read that, and you're like, yeah, no? Well, if I could have hands, and I don't know everybody's names, but Matthew 8:4, who would read that for me? Anybody just raise your hand.
I'll read.
All right, we got one Matthew. How about Matthew 16:20? All right, Brian's got it. Matthew 17:9. Anybody want to read? Who's got it? Drake?
Oh, yeah, I've heard it.
Drake's got it? All right, let's go. Mark 7:36. Mark 7:36. Any takers? Billy?
Yeah, I'd like to.
Mark 7:36. How about Mark 8:30? All right, Miss Linda. Mark 9:9. We'll stop there, but the rest of them say the same. You'll read it? Okay. All right, so when everybody gets to their scriptures, we'll let the first one go.
Ready? And Jesus saith unto him, see thou tell no man, but go thy way, show thyself to the priest, and offer the gift that Moses commanded for a testimony unto them.
Why would he do that, right? He's the Son of God. You with me? Let's keep going. 16:20, who's got it?
Then charged he his disciples that they should tell no man that he was Jesus the Christ.
Isn't that peculiar?
Mm-hmm.
Right? Now this is scripture. This isn't Brian.
Right.
All right, 17:9. Please.
And as they came down from the mountain, Jesus charged them, saying, tell the vision to no man until the Son of Man be risen again from the dead.
How about that? Let's go on. Who's got Mark 7?
7:36, is that right?
Yep.
All right. And he charged them that they should tell no man, but the more he charged them, so much the more a great deal they published it.
So what, most people, what they do? They'd still go tell, even though Jesus said don't tell. All right, let's go to Mark 8:30.
And he charged them that they should tell no man of him.
Is this peculiar? Why wouldn't you tell, right? We tell everybody, we're supposed to tell everybody about Jesus, right? But Jesus is telling them not to tell about him. Go on, one more. 9:9, Mark 9:9.
And as they came down from the mountain, he charged them that they should tell no man what things they had seen, till the Son of Man were risen from the dead.
Amen. So if you would go to Luke, it says the same thing, just in different context from a different author. And so the question is, what in the world's going on here, right? So if you will, turn with me to Numbers, the book of Numbers. And go to Numbers 35. Numbers is in the beginning of your book. I do that just so I can get there. I talk out loud like that all the time so I can remember where I'm going. Numbers 35. Now, by the way, this has nothing to do with Daniel's 70th week, but when I find something like this, it gets me. So I thought I would share it. Let's just start in verse 6. Numbers 35, verse 6. Okay? And among the cities, you shall give unto the Levites, there shall be 6 cities for refuge. Ye shall appoint for a manslayer, that he may flee hither. And to them ye shall add 42 cities. Jump on down to verse 11 through 12. I highly recommend you read Numbers 35 tonight, but I'm giving you the highlights of it so we can get through it. Verse 11 of Numbers 35. Then ye shall appoint you cities to be a city of refuge is big in this, for you, that the slayer may flee hither. There killeth any person at unaware. So what he's saying is, if you accidentally kill somebody, you, God is giving them a way out. You just got to go to a different city. Does that make sense? Okay. Verse 12. And they shall be unto you cities for a refuge from the avenger, that the manslayer die not until he stands before the congregation in judgment. Jump on down to verse 15. These six cities shall be a refuge both for the children of Israel and for a stranger or for a sojourner among them, that everyone that killeth a person unawares may flee hither. Do you see what he's saying? I'm giving you a place to go if it's an accident. And we go on, and if you read on down there through these verses, it says, if a piece of metal flies off and hits somebody, or a piece of wood or a piece of stone hits somebody in the head and kills them, and you didn't mean to do it, well, guess what? You're not going to be stoned to death, because if you killed at that time, guess what they did? They killed you, right? Okay, and then finally jump down to verse 25 through 28. And the congregation shall deliver the slayer out of the hand of the revenger of the blood, and the congregation shall restore him to the city of his refuge, whether he was fled, and he shall abide in it until the death of the high priest. Don't miss that. Which was appointed with the holy oil. But if the slayer shall at any time come within the border of the city of the refuge, whether he fled it, and the avenger of the blood find out that the borders of the city of his refuge and the revenger of the blood killed the slayer, he shall not be guilty of the blood, because he should have remained in the city of refuge until the death of the high priest. But after the death of the high priest, the slayer shall return into the land of his possession. So think about this one. Jesus is in Jerusalem and all his people, and he's telling them not to tell other people. And then they kill him.
He's their refuge.
Unknowing. You see, they didn't understand who he was. And then what did God do with Israel? He scattered them all throughout the world. And in the end times, what's he going to do? Call them all back to the city, because he is the high priest. How do you like those nuggets?
Pretty good.
That's pretty cool, right? Now read Numbers 35. But what God was doing was, God was taking a way for Israel to be saved by killing the person they did not know. You know, we can get out here and we can start chanting, and all of a sudden we'll get more people chanting and excited about things. Right? He was walking in, everybody's yelling Hosanna.
Amen.
But then 7 days later, they're saying kill him.
Yeah.
They don't really know even who they were talking about. Why? Because did they really ever tell him who he was? And did they understand who he was? Do you see what I'm saying? I thought that was pretty exciting to me. All right. And if you were to go to 2 Samuel 22:3, I'll just read it to you quickly. The God of my rock, I will trust in him. He is my shield. He is my horn of salvation. He is my tower. He is my refuge, my savior. Thou savest me from violence. He is their refuge. Over and over in the book of Psalms, he says, I am your refuge. And if you go into Numbers, he always gives them a city of refuge.
Amen.
You can't make up what God does. He's that cool. All right, the commitment. I'm back in the notes. Let's get back on track. All right, the commitment to restore and build Jerusalem had been decreed four times in Scripture. The fulfillment of this prophecy began with the decree of Cyrus in 536 B.C. Is everybody with me on the notes?
Amen.
Yeah? I'll let you get there. So four times, four different kings tell them they can go and build Jerusalem, right? This is in Scripture. So where do we start at? Cyrus was told this in 2 Chronicles 36, 22 and 23, Ezra 1, 1 through 4. Now again, we're not going to go through all these, but I can promise you they're there. I hope you go check me out. The second decree was done by Darius in 519 and 518 B.C., found in Ezra 6, 1 and 6 through 12. The third decree was the decree of Ahasuerus 1, so there's two Ahasuerus's, the decree of Ahasuerus 1 to Ezra in 457 and 458 BC, found in Ezra 7, 1 through 26. Okay? And finally, the fourth decree, and this is the one we're looking at, the big one. They're all big. The fourth decree was to Nehemiah in 444/445 BC in Nehemiah 2:1-8. This was fulfilled and was prophesied that concerning the rebuilding of the city, as Cyrus decreed, was for just rebuilding the temple. So in Daniel, it says, rebuild the temple, rebuild the city, rebuild the walls. This is the first time that ever happened. All the other ones before it just said, go build the temple. One said, make the temple more pretty. And we'll go on to read this. So Cyrus was decreeing to rebuild the temple. Darius decreed a simple to confirm what Cyrus had said. And Ahasuerus I concerned only doing additional exiles and to beautify the temple. So the first three decrees did not fulfill what God said would happen. Right? The fourth decree by Ahasuerus to Nehemiah fulfills what God said would happen. And that was the restoration of the city. Everybody okay with that?
Amen.
I hope we're not jumping too much. I know this is a lot.
Is there a question?
Yeah.
I could be wrong. Was Daniel, I know Israel went, 300 and some odd years without a prophet? Before the coming, before John the Baptist.
Yes.
So was Daniel that last prophet?
Time wise, Justin, I don't know the answer. So I can say I don't know.
I don't know it either.
I don't know that Daniel was the last prophet. I don't think he was.
I know, like I say, they went that time frame.
Does anybody know that answer to that question? Was Daniel the last prophet?
There was a prophecy there.
Mm-hmm.
Malachi's a prophet, right?
Mm-hmm. I don't know where Malachi lines up with Daniel. It's a great question. It's something I will try to find for you, but I can't answer that.
Well, if we look at our Bible, the way it's laid out,
right.
You know, there's prophets there's prophecy after Daniel, but, you know, Daniel's 70th week is talking about this, you know, and I know that until the Messiah came, that's just food for thought. I don't know. I don't know.
That's a great question. If anybody has an answer, go ahead and help me that way. I'm going to study it out. Okay. Let's try to finish up. We're close, I think. I don't know how much time we got. The Messiah being cut off refers to the crucifixion of Christ. Is everybody okay with that?
Amen.
Occurring in, now here's, let me just back up and say this before we go any further. We can't just lay this out, pinpoint it precisely. And here's the reason why. Nobody knows the exact date when Christ was born. The year, okay? And if we did, because you can go and Google this and look at this and you can find 10,000 maps, 10,000 ways. There was no 0 BC or AD. So there was a 1 BC and a 1 AD, right? So we count that as 2 years or 1 year. You see what I'm saying? There's a little mathematical confusion. So in all the maps I gave you, it tells you different times that Christ is crucified and Christ is born. Because we really can't pinpoint it. Nobody ever has. Although if we look to the moon and we see when the full moon is and when the Passover was, we have good ideas. But we can't really pinpoint that. That's just one thing God knows and we don't. So we got to kind of be subject to that. So all of these will have a little bit different numbers in them with that. I hope you guys are okay with that. I asked God, but he didn't tell me. So I said, God, you know I'm teaching that. I really need some help here, but he didn't see fit for me to know, so I'll thank him for his grace. Okay, ending the 69th week from which the decree to rebuild the city had occurred. This prophetic fulfillment of the 483 years, and if you divide that by the Jewish calendar, is
173,000.
Yes, thank you. Days complete. But all 1 week of the final prophecy, which is left, which is the 7 years for Israel to come. Okay, so we have 7 weeks, which equals the 49 years. You had the 62 weeks until the Messiah was cut off. That equals 434 years. If you add 62 to 483, you will end up with 434. You'll get 483 years. So if I subtract that from 490, how many weeks do I have left?
7 years.
7 years or 1 week?
1 week.
So in the notes, during the 7 weeks, which was spoken of in Daniel there, or in Nehemiah, the 445 BC of the rebuilding of Jerusalem is found in Nehemiah 3 through 6. Remember I said Nehemiah was holding the trowel with one hand and they had the weapon in the other? Well, you can find that in Nehemiah chapter 3 through 6. The 62 weeks or the 434 years leading up to the cutting off of the Messiah, the Prince, we find in Daniel 9:25, and it says, "Now, therefore, and understand that going forth from the commandment to restore and to build Jerusalem unto the Messiah, the Prince, shall be cut off, shall be 7 weeks, and 62 weeks. The street shall be rebuilt again, and the walls, even in troublesome times." So do you see how this is all prophecies being fulfilled here?
Amen.
Okay. If you don't, we can go back and do it again. It took me a while to get it. "And after 62 weeks shall Messiah be cut off, but not for himself. And the people of the Prince that shall come to destroy the city and the sanctuary and end thereof shall be with a flood. And unto the end of the war, desolation are determined." So just to show you what God does, if you want to turn to Zechariah 9:9, that's another little prophet that stays hidden in my book, hard to find. Zechariah 9:9. Everybody got it?
Yep.
Yes, sir.
Zechariah 9:9. "Rejoice greatly, O daughter Zion. Shout, O daughter Jerusalem. Behold, thy king cometh unto thee. He is just and having salvation, lowly, riding upon an ass, upon a colt, the foal of an ass." We found that right there. So there's a prophecy saying what's going to happen. So Israel could not say, "We don't know what's going on." Do you see that? But they just didn't understand Scripture. Right? John 12:13 says something very similar, but I'm going to go just to Matthew 12:1-12. Matthew 21:1-12. Matthew 21:1-12. And here we go. "And when they drew near to, unto Jerusalem, and were come into Bethany, upon the Mount of Olives, then sent Jesus two disciples, saying unto them, Go into the village again, over against you. Straightway ye shall find an ass tied, and a colt with her. Loose them, and bring them to me. And if any man says anything to you, ye shall say, The Lord has need of them, and straightway he shall send them. All this was done, that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet." You see that?
Amen.
The prophet said it. Guess what? When God says it, it's going to happen. I'm just showing you it happened. That's my whole point in this. This really was Jesus coming. There was no mistake that this was the Son of God. Now, we know that, but I'm saying they didn't have the book like we got the book. They don't have the end story, so we throw rocks at them all the time. But the point being, they didn't have everything we had. Yes, they should study Scripture, and yes, they should have known he was there, but they didn't. Thank God he didn't for the time of grace.
Amen.
All right, so if you'll go one more time to Luke 1:68. So if somebody says, "What is Daniel's 70th week?" I hope you say it is the tribulation, right?
Amen.
It's the last 7 years to be fulfilled. Now, to actually explain that, we'd have to go into the book of Revelation, and I don't think you guys want to do that. That would be, whew. But we're talking about how do we know Daniel's 70th week and even what Scripture's talking about, right? And that's what I'm saying. What'd you say? That'd be some trouble there. Luke 1, verse 68. Blessed be the Lord God of
Israel
and the Gentile nations.
Nope.
It doesn't say that, does it? He hath visited and redeemed whose people?
His people.
So who's his people?
Israel.
Okay, now you're starting to put this together. And hath raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David, as he spoke by the mouth of his holy prophets, which has been since the world began. Listen, they knew he was coming. They just killed him. They missed it by a mile.
Yep.
Okay? They had scripture to back this up. We just showed you that. And there was more scripture, but I just picked one. That he should be saved from our enemies. Who's their enemies? If God came to get the whole world at that time, who would he have enemies? The enemies are the Gentiles.
Amen.
You understand that? Israel was his people. The world was his enemy. And from the hand of all who hate us, who hated the Jews? The Gentiles. You have to rightly divide the book. We don't have to, but it's a big mess if you don't. To perform the mercy promised to our fathers and to remember his holy covenants. Did he ever promise the Gentiles anything? Not nothing. I don't know if that's good English, but... But it was not nothing, right? What he promised in Genesis 12, 1 through 3, he promised Abraham a nation with a seed, and from that all would be blessed. But guess what they didn't do? They didn't accept him.
Yeah.
All right, so to perform the mercies promised of our fathers and to remember the holy covenants, the oath with which swear unto our father Abraham, that he would grant unto us that they being delivered out of the hand of the enemies, that would be Gentile nations, might serve him without fear, in holiness and righteousness before him all the days of his life. And thou, child, shalt be called the prophet of the Most High, for thou shalt go before the face of the Lord to prepare his way. Now they're talking about John the Baptist here. He's going to go away there. To give knowledge unto salvation unto whose people? His people, by the remission of their sins, through the tender mercies of God, thereby the day spring, and from the high hath visited us. Right? I'm just going to real quick go through this, and we'll finish up tonight, I hope. John 1, 10 through 9, the true light came into the world, which lighteth every man that cometh into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made by him, and the world knew him not. And he came to his own, and his own received him not.
Amen.
Very good. Amos 9:14. I will bring again into captivity of my people of Israel. Amos 9:14-15. And I will bring again the captivity of my people of Israel. And they shall build a waste city and inhabit them. And they shall plant vineyards and drink the wine thereof. They shall also make gardens and eat the fruit thereof, and I will plant them upon their land, and there shall be no more pulled out of their land which I have given unto them, saith the Lord. See, he's promising Israel they're going to be secure at some time. Has Israel ever been secure? Are they secure now? But God's promising. Jeremiah 16:14 says, therefore I will cast you out of the land into the land that ye know not. Remember we said he pushed Israel everywhere? Neither ye know your fathers, and there you shall serve other gods day and night, where I will not show you favor. Therefore, behold, comes the day, saith the Lord, that I shall no more be said, the Lord liveth, that brought up the child of Israel out of Egypt. But the Lord liveth, that brought up the children of Israel from the land of the north, from all the lands, whether it had driven them out. And I will bring them into their lands again, and I will give unto their fathers. What's he doing? He's saying, I'm driving you out, but I promise you I'm going to bring you back in. That's what that says. And that's Jeremiah 16:14-15, if you want to check me out. Just a couple more. I just want to prove to you God is God. Not that you need it. Isaiah 43:5-6. Fear not, for I am with thee. I will bring thy seed from the east. I will gather thee from the west. I will say to the north, give her up, and to the south, keep not back. Bring my sons from afar, my daughters from the ends of the earth. even every one that is called by my name, for I have created him for my glory. I have formed them. I have made them. Sounds like a great promise, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Finally, this is the covenant that God wants to fulfill that's never been fulfilled. If everybody would turn to Jeremiah 31 for me. Jeremiah 31. I am skipping so many things right here. I'm telling you, we can go on and on about this. This is so good. Can I read two more scriptures? Do you mind? Jeremiah, and then we'll read Hebrews, and I'll be done, I promise.
No, you're done, fine.
Jeremiah 31. Jeremiah 31, 31. Now listen, these next two things I want to read to you, I hope this shows you that God is true and he loves Israel and he's going to do what he said to Israel. And we are not Israel replacement theology. Behold, the days come, saith the Lord. I'm in Jeremiah 31, verse 31. Behold, the days come, saith the Lord. I will make a new covenant with the house of
Israel
and with the house of
Judah.
Not according to, and well, I'm going to stop right there. I hope somebody could find scripture that shows me that we are now Israel or Judah. I've never found it. I've looked for it, but I can't spiritualize the body of Christ. It is something totally different.
Amen.
But if you find it, please show me, because I would like to say I'm wrong, if I'm wrong. The house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day I took them out by the hand and brought them out of the land of Egypt, which my covenant they break. Although I was a husband unto them, saith the Lord. But this shall be the covenant that I will make with the house of
Israel.
And after those days, saith God the Lord, I will put my law in their inward parts, I will write in their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. And they shall teach no more every man his neighbor, and every man his brother, saying, Know the Lord, for they shall know me. From the least of them to the greatest of them, saith the Lord, I will forgive them of their iniquities and their sins no more. They are not forgiven. And you say, are you sure about that? Please go to Hebrews. Hebrews 8, and we are done. I promise you. We know God's got prophecy. We know it's not been fulfilled. And we know God is going to fulfill it. Or he is a liar. And the book clearly says God cannot lie.
Amen.
So now you have a choice. Do you believe God in this book, or do you believe something else? Hebrews 8, verse 7. And this is the new covenant for the Jews, not the church. For if the first covenant had been faultless, then should be no place have been sought for a second. Right? He made a covenant with them. They broke it. But he's going to provide a second one, which we just read. For finding fault with them, he said, Behold, the day shall come, saith the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of, and with the house of. So it's the same thing. It's lining up, right? It's not a new covenant for the body of Christ. This is Israel. Not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers when the day I took them in by the hand and led them out of Egypt, because they continued not in my. And I regarded them, saith the Lord, for this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after the days, and they shall be to me a people. And they shall not teach every man his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, Know the Lord, for all shall know me from the least to the greatest, for I will be merciful to their unrighteousness. That's why Israel is still up there on the Western Wall doing this. They missed the Messiah.
Amen.
They missed the prince. They missed the king. They missed everything you could call Jesus. They missed it by a mile. And their sins and their iniquities will I remember no more. In that he saith, a new covenant he hath made the old. In that he saith, a new covenant he hath made the old, first old. Now that which decayeth and waxeth old is ready to be banished away.
Amen.
Do you see that? But they have to go through Daniel's 70th week. They have to go through Jacob's trouble because they killed Jesus.
Amen.
But he gave them the way out by not telling him who he was so they could come back to the land. Two-thirds of them are going to perish. One-third is going to be saved. Bible clearly says that. I don't know if you guys want to stone me or if we're good. But scripture is really cool. It always backs itself up. There's so many nuggets. God just continues. If you'll search with scripture, it always backs itself up. I really appreciate you guys giving me the chance to teach, and I thank you. If you have questions or comments, please ask now or after class, whatever. Yes, ma'am.
I have one question here. When you were reading that, he says, I regarded them not. What does that mean?
He regards them not as his people, right? He puts them in time out. Because of what did they do? They were stiff-necked. They defiled him. He's been in love with him. He's like the husband, and that's the cheating wife. He lets her come back. She cheats. Well, I mean, that's really, if you look in Jeremiah, that's where we get the word backsliding, right?
Amen.
Because Israel backslid over and over and over. Read the book of Judges. Read any book. It doesn't matter. And what do? They cry out to him, oh, Lord, and by his grace, he would come back. Yes, ma'am.
It's in John. Let me read in John.
Yeah.
It says, that was the true light which lighteth every man that cometh into the world.
Mm-hmm.
Does that really mean every man?
So, the heavens declare his glory, right? What I'm saying is, we can try to say that we don't know God, but you have to know that there's something bigger,
yeah.
Right? And there's a light in us. There's something that seeks God. But what did I do? I fulfilled it with every lust of this flesh. Right? I was so stubborn and prideful that I tried everything to fulfill me other than the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
That was a big mess for me in my life. But once it... You get what I'm saying? There's a self-seeking inside you. You are made...
Something's missing and you look for it.
Exactly. And he has given you that light. The light is so easy to be seen. You wake up tomorrow, the sun's going to rise. You may not rise, but the sun's going to. See, because the world can go on without you. Does that make sense?
Yes, but I'm just wondering,
mm-hmm.
You know, why do some people choose to kill people if the light's there? I mean...
Well, the reason why is because of sin.
You say the light's every man. You don't mm-hmm. need anybody else.
Absolutely, but can we not reject the Holy Spirit? I mean... I'm not personally wanting to know your testimony or nothing, but I mean, how many times did I not come forth? How many times did I deny and do something else? Right? And so my mind can get more worldly or it can get more godly. That's the free will of man.
It's like whichever one you feed.
Amen. It's whichever one you feed. Absolutely.
All right.
You're absolutely correct.
Thank you.
Yeah. Remember, because we're created from his womb. Now, when we're born, we're born into sin. And you don't have to tell your kid to steal. You don't have to tell my kids anyway,
or lie.
To steal or lie or hit each other. Or I mean, it's just natural,
yeah.
Right? It's just inherent, really. Mm-hmm. But it's a great question. Anybody else?
If his light starts to show us.
What does he say to do with our kids? Teach them the scripture, right? Mm-hmm. Show them the way.
Thank you.
Yep, thank you. Anybody else? Well, I thank you again for class and right. Is there any more prayer requests or any thoughts? We had some other people come in late. You're not going to hell for that, by the way. I don't know. You guys, you can work that out with Brother Justin there, and we'll close. If there's no prayer requests or anything, if you don't mind, I'll close some prayer tonight. God, I thank you that these four walls can't hold you. I thank you that your spirit dwells everywhere in every way, God. I just thank you for your mercy and your grace, your loving kindness. Lord, I thank you for these people that have come. I pray that they've been uplifted by your word, God. I pray that they continue to seek you and to just watch what you'll do in their lives if they just stick with you. Father, I hope somebody watches this today or whenever it's published, Lord, and I hope it opens their eyes to how great you are and how you will fulfill every promise that you ever made. I love you, Lord, and I thank you for everything. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, guys.